Thank you and good morning and welcome to the ninth meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2022. This morning we will conclude our evidence taking on the inquiry into excess deaths in Scotland since the start of the pandemic. I would like to welcome to the meeting Hamza Yousaf, Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care, and Professor Jason Leach, National Clinical Director for the Scottish Government. Cabinet Secretary, would you like to make any short opening remarks before we move to questions?
Convener, can I apologise for being slightly late, and in view of the fact that I am slightly late, I'm more than happy to pass back to you and go straight into questions and answers so we have as much time as possible for that.
Brilliant, thanks very much. Okay, if I may ask the first question, can I ask Cabinet Secretary's interpretation of the data on excess deaths during the pandemic, and in particular your view on the Public Health Scotland report that from July 2021 onwards the pattern changed with almost all causes of death being in excess?
I think I'll probably say a few things about this. First and foremost, can I welcome the committee's inquiry into this and your detailed analysis, and I've had time to read over and look over and where I've been able to listen to the evidence you've taken. I think it's been a reminder for every single person around this table just how sobering that data has been, and just how every single person, I think, in Scotland has been touched in some way, shape or form by a tragedy involving COVID. That could be a family who, or an individual in a family who've suffered from long COVID right the way through to people who've been bereaved by COVID, and I think we will talk a lot about statistics and numbers in this session, and with good cause, but just a reminder, of course, that behind each of those statistics is genuinely a human tragedy. So in general, in terms of the data, and I will touch upon the latter point of your question, we know that since the start of the pandemic there's been 12,140 excess deaths from all causes. It's 11% higher than the five-year average, demonstrating COVID-19's impact. Over the same period there was 13,429 deaths involving COVID, and 11,443 deaths where COVID was the underlying cause. That's 85% of all the deaths involving COVID. So the excess death measure during the pandemic period clearly demonstrates COVID's impact. In terms of the change and how the pattern changed, as you said, in the latter half of 2021, I would strongly associate my remarks with those of previous evidence session that you heard here, remarks by Dr. Linda Fenton, who's a public health medicine consultant at Public Health Scotland, and her remarks around recognising that in view of the breadth, there's likely to have been both health service factors, and again, I'm certain we will get into this in the committee discussion, as well as factors that are related to the determinants of health, and that there's there was a point made by Peter Hasty from Macmillan Cancer Support, who I've got a lot of time for, both him as an individual but also Macmillan Cancer Support, that there was no debate whatsoever that people with cancer are being diagnosed later than pre-pandemic, and I certainly think that also factors into those figures. Also, of course, when we look at the latter half of 2021, we have a vaccination programme that was well into its stride, and there's no doubt again that vaccines have played an important role against the severest impacts of COVID, and of course COVID mortality too, and that perhaps is demonstrating itself in those figures as well. I don't know if there's anything else particularly that Professor Leach wants to add to that, given his clinical expertise in this area.
Morning, everybody. Maybe I can go back a step, because since we last spoke, we've had a two-week break. It's unlike us. There's been a very, very important excess mortality paper published in The Lancet last week, which looked at the whole world for the first time. Now, we always knew it was going to take time, and all the chat about the UK having the worst mortality in the world and all of it, we all knew that was not going to be true in the longer term. And sure enough, it's not. The excess mortality paper published last week in The Lancet looked at pretty much every country they could get their hands on, which was about half the world. And our death certification in the UK and most of Western Europe is exemplary. In much of the world, it isn't. So the global average using excess mortality is about 100 per 100,000 deaths in the 2 years of the first 2 years of this horrible, horrible infectious disease. But there are 21 countries with over 300 per 100,000. India has amongst the highest. Russia and the US have 300 per 100,000. The raw numbers are eye-watering. 4 million people in India have died of this disease. 4 million. And it's just quite remarkable. It's almost the population of Scotland have died of COVID and COVID-related disease in one country. So when you then look at the UK's numbers, you get about that worldwide average. You get to about, it's 1-2-6. But there's confidence intervals, of course, because of the nature of the statistics. And you get to about the UK, all four countries being, and forgive this shorthand when we're talking about death, in the middle of the pack. And that's roughly where all of us thought we would be. And that's what we've been trying to manage to get to with vaccination, with lockdowns early on, with the provision of safety measures since. So I think it's important to put excess deaths in context, because we're now in a place where we have COVID, but we have no flu. We have COVID, we have the economy open, we have et cetera, et cetera. So you need to look at it. Excess deaths in a week are irrelevant. Excess deaths over a period, like a global pandemic, are absolutely crucial. And it will be the way we judge the public health measures of the world over the long period. So I was shocked and once again miserable when I read the toll this disease has taken. But the UK has behaved and performed relatively well from a public health perspective, if you look at the whole thing. My final headline number is the number of COVID deaths announced by every country in the world is about 5 million. The number of COVID deaths actually is 18 million. So that gives you the difference. And our number, the UK's number, the Scottish number, relates almost exactly to the number we've announced. So our excess mortality number is pretty much the same as the number we've announced for COVID. In other countries, there are massive differences because there's not a mature death certificate system, etc. So that would be my...
Thank you. I think it's really important that we do look at Scotland on a comparison to the globe, if we've got that information in the last week as well. Can I ask, and I know there are constant pressures on the NHS staff-wise at the moment, but do we have any indication when the screening services will be fully back up and running, for example, the breast screening for over 70s?
You're right, of course, to couch that question, excuse me, in terms of the pressures. And I'm not speaking out of turn by saying in the conversations that I've had in the course of this week with health boards and my officials have had this week, many of the health boards are giving us the consistent message that they feel like this week is probably the toughest week that they've faced in the course of the pandemic. We haven't had today's numbers and haven't been published yet in terms of those in hospital with COVID, but yesterday's numbers, just under 2,000, add to that a high level of delayed discharge and many, and I was talking to Glasgow Health and Social Care Partnership yesterday, unable to discharge people to care homes given the scale of outbreak at the moment. And add to that staff absences, as well as the accumulated pressure this week. It looks like it's shaping up to be, if not the worst week of the pandemic, or the most challenging week of the pandemic from a health service perspective, certainly one of the most challenging. In terms of routine screening programmes, all adult screening programmes have resumed safely, but of course, although they have restarted, it's fair to say they are playing catch-up in some respects. In terms of breast screening cancer, it's restarted, and of course, anybody with signs or symptoms of breast cancer should seek a screening. We've put in place an action to address the capacity challenges in terms of screening that we're facing. Cervical screening, again, we're looking at, for example, we're having to clinically prioritise, again, because of the capacity issues, those that are higher risk participants in non-routine pathways are currently being prioritised. Bowel screening has resumed, and new home testing kits have been sent out. And that programme actually generally is operating in line with pre-COVID performance. The AAA screening, abdominal aortic aneurysm screening, has resumed, and men in the highest risk cohorts are being prioritised, and diabetic eye screening again has resumed, being targeted towards those who have the greatest risk of developing diabetic retinopathy. So we're resumed, but there's a clinical prioritisation that's having to happen given the backlogs and the capacity constraints that we have.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'll move to Murdo Fraser for questions, please.
I think
In relation to the question, just for complete clarity, we don't routinely breast screen over 70s women. Routine breast screening stops at 70. You can self-refer over 70 for breast screening if you're worried. That self-referral just to the breast screening clinics was paused in order to prioritise exactly as the Cabinet Secretary has described. That doesn't mean over 70s women can't get breast screened. Of course they can. And the way they should do that is by going to their general practitioner. If they have any worries about lumps, bumps, bleeding, anything at all, they should go and see their general practitioner. So the 50 to 70-year-old breast screening is back and working at full capacity. The self-referral to breast screening buses and breast screening clinics has paused for the over 70s, but we never did that routinely anyway. That was for people who wanted to self-refer. That route is presently your general practitioner.
Thank
you. Having had a conversation yesterday with the screening team around this, we do know that that's a different position in Scotland than it is, for example, in England and Wales. So we are looking to see how we can quickly resume that self-referral. And I would hope to do that and hope to be able to see something more on that in the coming weeks. Ahead, we just have to bear in mind that if we do allow that self-referral for those that are 71 and over to take place, then it could cause slippage between cycles for those who are within the 50 to 70 category. Now we may judge that the risk of doing the benefit of allowing that self-referral outweighs that risk, and that's the conversation that we're having. And as I said, I actually had yesterday with the breast cancer screening team.
Thank you, that's helpful, because I've got a constituent who has breast cancer history that's over 70, so thank you. Murdo?
Thank you. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and Professor Leach. And Professor Leach, I was glad you raised the Lancet paper, which I thought was a very interesting study and actually gave us actually quite a lot of reassurance about the choices that we made in terms of tackling COVID. I thought one of the other interesting aspects of it was it argued that there was no clear relationship between levels of excess mortality and different levels of restrictions that have been applied, and put the emphasis much more on vaccination. But that's a debate we'll be having, I think, later this morning, I suspect. Just going back to the inquiry, we've taken a lot of evidence over the last few weeks around this whole question of reduced access to services. And this is really, I think, has been at the core of many of the issues, people not being able to see their GP, not get access to basic screening. So, Cabinet Secretary, you know, would you agree this has had an impact on patient outcomes? And are there particular parts of the patient pathway, such as primary care, that have been the major cause of problems leading to excess deaths currently and also in the future?
Yes, I do agree. I think it would be foolish not to agree with that statement. I think it's absolutely the case that the pandemic, and I often describe it in these terms, as the biggest shock our health service has ever faced in its existence. It is impossible for that not to have had an impact and effect on access to services, and no doubt, therefore, then the outcomes on people's health and in public health more generally. And again, I looked at the evidence and read the evidence that you have taken thus far, and it's compelling. The compelling evidence from clinicians, from third sector organisations, that people have not presented in a way that they would have done pre-pandemic. And that undoubtedly has an impact, and it has an impact right across the country, and it has an impact right across the patient pathway from diagnosis right the way through to treatment and aftercare. In terms of the second part of your question, are there any particular parts of the patient pathway? And you reference primary care. Again, everybody around this table knows well that primary care is often the front door. It's the first port of call, and that can be doctors, dentists, and right the way through to the whole range of primary care. And they have been affected. Again, I was at was it a surgery? I think that probably Murdo Fraser knows well. Was it the T-mount surgery? I didn't know that. See,
although I don't trouble them very much.
Patient confidentiality clearly is working very well because I wasn't told that. But I was then seeing Dr. Shackles and some of the team there at the T-mount surgery. And they've done exceptionally well. And they're part of a group that also has a surgery, as again Murdo Fraser will know, in Scone as well. And they were saying to me that although they are a relatively large surgery, they have had challenges. But if I look at surgeries like my own medical practice, much smaller, and therefore actually their ability to see people face to face has been more constrained. Now, as we recover from the pandemic, and we are recovering and will recover, we'll need to look at a hybrid model whereby telephone consultation, video consultation, as well as face-to-face and increasing face-to-face has got to be part of that model. Dentistry has been hit really hard, because of obviously the nature of the aerosol-generating procedures that they undertake and the IPC that goes around that. And again, we're recovering, but that is going to take time, and particularly as we continue to have the IPC controls absolutely in place. In terms of patient pathways, many of them give me concerns. Probably the one that gives me the most concern, I suspect I'm not alone in this around this table, is cancer and cancer pathway. And you heard again very compelling evidence, I thought, from a range of organisations that represent those with again a variety of cancers. We have evidence that there's somewhere in the region of 5,000 quote unquote missing cancer patients from 2020. During the first 9 months of the pandemic, there was 2,681 patients diagnosed with breast cancer, 1,958 diagnosed with colorectal cancer, and 3,287 patients diagnosed with lung cancer. In numbers, these are 19%, 25%, and 9% respectively lower than would have been expected in that period if COVID hadn't happened. So when I think about patient pathways, there's of course a range of pathways that I'm concerned about, but genuinely cancer, and that's why it's given such a priority by this government.
Okay, thank you for that response. That's very helpful. Just to go back on the question of GPs, I'm a patient at that GP practice, although fortunately they don't see me very often.
They would say the same, I think.
Yeah, yeah. Well, indeed, we're both happy. I mean, one of the things that has come out of this inquiry is the question of access to GPs. Now, you know, we've heard from Dr. Andrew Buist from the BMA, who, you know, pushes back really strongly on the notion that people didn't get access to GPs. But we still hear this coming back. We hear it from constituents. We hear it anecdotally. You know, do you think we are now back to a position with access to GPs where it should be, or are we still facing challenges?
No, I would like to see an increase in face-to-face, but as part of a hybrid model. And that's what I agree with Dr. Buist, Dr. Shackles, many of the others who will represent the GPs and others at GP services. That it's not, I don't think anybody, including, again, anybody around this table, would suggest that GPs haven't been working hard throughout the pandemic. They have. And one thing that we need to improve upon is data. I know this was a question that was asked by other committee members during the inquiry. And so we're working on a project to get better data extraction from primary care. I've seen the first cut of that data extract. It needs to be quality assured and so on and so forth, and it'll go through that process, and I promise the committee it will be published as soon as it goes through that appropriate process. But certainly the first cut of that data is unsurprising, in that GPs are working incredibly hard, but as part of a hybrid model. And I do think that hybrid model should remain for people. You know, I contacted my GP a number of months ago now, and it was much more convenient for me to be able to telephone and do a video consultation and get my eczema cream and get it, pick it up at the pharmacist, and all of that saved me the journey to the GP's clinic and the time involved in that. So I think as part of a hybrid model, yes, we want to see an increase in face-to-face appointments. And you know, what Murdo Fraser is hearing anecdotally from his constituents and what I hear anecdotally from mine, you know, is something I hear from, for example, nurses in the admission wards in acute hospitals too. So I think there is more to do in relation to increasing the level of face-to-face, but we have to recognise that we still, GP practices are still operating under some really difficult IPC conditions.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Can I bring in Alex Rowley, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. You mentioned, Cabinet Secretary, the evidence we've had previously, and Lawrence Cowan for Heart and Chest and Stroke mentioned that the British Heart Foundation had done a study where that showed that there had been significant increases in unhealthy behaviours, such as eating unhealthy, smoking, and an increase in isolation and loneliness. And they then went on to look specifically at poverty. You mentioned Peter Hasty. Peter Hasty says that health inequalities remain at the heart of everything that McMillan Cancer Support do. If a person lives in a deprived area in Scotland, they are more likely to get cancer, to be diagnosed later, and to die. I cannot see how it would be possible for the pandemic to have improved this. Rob Gowans then, in the same evidence session, gives a number of things need to happen. We know that the number of excess deaths in the most deprived areas is twice what it is in the least deprived areas. We need better data, in particular data that is disaggregated on age, sex, race and other aspects of socio-economic background. So my question, there is a question there about data and what kind of data we are actually collecting. But there is also a question about prioritising, I suppose, and focusing on the most deprived areas and what we actually do about that. And my final point on that, back to Lawrence Cowan, because I had asked him about joined up working. I assume that we all agree that we don't see the NHS as just the acute. And we know that there's a primary sector, there's a local authority sector. But Lawrence Cowan, quite worryingly, he says at the moment we're doing a lot of partnership working with the health boards, which is really positive. However, we're doing all the running. It should be an automatic system so that when patients are discharged from hospital, they are discharged automatically to a wealth of services. That happens in some areas, but not others. So whilst I recognise the pressure that specifically NHS services are in, it seems to me there's a massive resource out there that we're not pulling together, i.e. joined up government. What would your view on that be?
Thanks a lot for, first of all, giving some really important context to your comments and questions. I don't disagree with the notion that we could do even better in relation to integration. And actually, the third sector plays a massive role in that. And I was in a meeting not too many months ago, again, on the issue of delayed discharge, which I know Alex Rowley has raised on many occasions, both in this committee and in the chamber. And a third sector interface, the local third sector interface was part of that conversation. But there was a number of people from the third sector saying exactly as Lawrence has said there, that we feel like we're having to be proactive. And so I've certainly communicated that to health boards and local integration authorities that, you know, they should be using every single resource out in the community that they possibly can. Now, I think our welfare rights money advice services across 150 primary care settings over the last 2 years in deprived communities in particular, I think our community link workers, and probably all as MSPs have a good relationship with our community link workers, they are vital in helping to make those connections. But I'll be also frank, and I'm sure this is a debate for another day in more detail, but it's also why I think the National Care Service is so important, because social care is so vital to help us in relation to the pressures that we're facing, and social care is under enormous pressure itself. But we know that if we have that consistency of care right across the country, it could make an important difference to the pressures that our NHS is facing as well. So I don't disagree with that. There's a really good piece of work we just published last week, I think, from a Short Life working group looking at health inequalities in primary care. And Dr. Carrie Lunan, who again I suspect will be known to everybody around the committee and some of her colleagues from the deep end, have done some brilliant work in that regard. So I would commend that piece of work to anybody that hasn't seen it.
Okay, thank you. I mean, my point to you would be that, you know, I know there's a massive pressure on all resources, but I believe that there is a lot of resource out there. And that evidence session we took, indeed evidence sessions before that, Dr. Buist, amongst others, where we've asked, is health and social care actually working on the ground? is the social work and the GP practice. It's a hit and a miss. And I don't think that can... Well, it's not just about resources. It's about leadership. It's about management. And it has to be about leadership for the top, I would have thought. But can I, given that you're here, can I pick up on my final question, which is that I had a look at the Public Health Scotland national statistics, and there was a Spice report which said that basically the... number of cancer deaths recorded at home or non-institutional settings in the early months of the pandemic was substantially higher than in hospital. And that trend seems to continue, but in NHS 5, the average daily occupied beds for palliative support, hospice support, dropped from 20 down to 9, while 22 beds were available. And to round it off, the percentage drop in occupied beds was 86.3 down to 39.7. So in terms of palliative care, hospice care, Fife is the lowest, by the way. I think Highlands is next on 53%. So that massive drop, what are we going to do about that? Because we know that for some people, you know, it's about how you care for people that are dying. Some people want to stay at home, but for families, a lot of people want that level of support, and it seems to be missing.
So first of all, on the specifics around Fife, I'm due to meet with Fife, both in terms of the health board, actually the local government and the local HSCP, and Nicky Connor and the team who do an excellent job there. And actually my conversations with them in autumn, winter last year were really helpful, because we were going in the wrong direction in terms of delayed discharge and managed to pull that back. Now, I'm afraid because of Omicron and the most recent wave, we've begun to go in the wrong direction again. On the more specific question, I will look at that and I will raise that directly with NHS 5. We know that the pattern that Alex Rowley mentions there around palliative care, we know there have been deaths at home that need further investigation throughout the course of the pandemic. So what we have decided to do is we've committed to produce a palliative care and end-of-life care strategy to ensure that people and their loved ones get the care and support that's right for them when they need it the most, and to help inform that strategy, because I think some of the data still could be more robust. The Scottish Centre for Administrative Data Research, they're already undertaking research to investigate home deaths during the COVID-19 pandemic in Scotland, and that work will be helpful in understanding for us in terms of the strategy that we're looking to develop, so we can understand more clearly the causes of the shift in place of death during the pandemic, and whether this is going to be a long-term trend or not, which is something then again we'd need to make sure we have the appropriate structures and indeed where necessary the appropriate funding in place. So that's a bit the more general issue. In terms of the more specific on Fife, I'll take that one up with the appropriate partners who I'm due to meet relatively soon.
Thank you, Camilla.
Thank you. Jim Fairley, would you like to come in?
No.
Sure. Brian
Mitchell. Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and Professor Leach. Can I go back to the excess deaths? And I think the comment earlier on that the majority of excess deaths are due in part to COVID. I think the reality, if I remember correctly, and I'm sure you correct me if I'm wrong here, but it's really COVID is a contributing factor. And then when we look back, that obesity had a high... There was a high proportion of people, some over 60% of people who'd died from COVID or COVID-related were obese. There was a third of them sort of diabetes was a factor in that as well. I'm looking ahead here. Do we have an opportunity here, Cabinet Secretary, to reset and reassess how we deliver healthcare and link it to factors that are outside of the NHS, really? You know, looking at how we can... education system in the broadest sense of the word... As my colleague has just said there, poverty was a high instances of COVID death in poverty. Do we have an opportunity here looking ahead to reset? And if you agree with that, how will the government take that up?
I do agree with that, and I should acknowledge that you, Brian Whittle, has had a long-standing interest in this issue and advocated for a model that looks at the preventative, and I think that's incredibly important. And you know, we are many years after the Christie Commission. And we invest heavily in preventative, but I certainly think there's more we can do in that space. I think education can play a role, absolutely, in that. I think social prescribing, again, which we are looking to further. I've mentioned the community link workers that we have. We've obviously committed to 1,000 additional support workers in relation to mental health that every GP practice in Scotland can have access to. That is to assist with social prescribing. And I think the ability to do that is incredibly important. I think sport plays a huge role in that. I'm just of a really good meeting recently with the Scottish FA in terms of actually how we use, you know, Scotland's most loved sport, how we use that in that grassroots network of football clubs right across the country. How do we use that more strategically for some of our health aims moving forward? So I think there's a lot we're doing in this space, but plenty more. And Brian Whittle's kind of description or phraseology of that as being an opportunity, I think, is correct. I think it is an opportunity out of really tragic circumstances to improve our public health outcomes.
If I move on, I mean, it's not sport for sport's sake. It's education through sport and physical activity, I think, is probably the phrase that I would rather use, rather than, because I think everybody thinks when I talk about sport, I'm going to make everybody go and do 8 400s. It's just not quite where I'm at. I'm looking at the high. I wouldn't attempt it myself. If we move on from that, and then if we go back to the question of data, which I think is where, in my view, and I would ask the Cabinet Secretary if this is of interest to him, to look back at the work that the Health and Sport Committee did in the last session around this and around social prescribing. The data is incredibly important, and I think Professor Leach highlighted that with his discussion there around data globally and how important it is. A lot of the evidence we've gathered, and that evidence has followed us from the previous session, is there is a lack of data collection or coordination of data collection, and that would hamper our plan, our ability to plan ahead, our ability to almost recreate, if you like, or reassess the way we deliver healthcare. And sitting on top of that is we do not have an IT system within the NHS here that is fit for purpose. You know, the data doesn't follow the patient, for example, from primary care into secondary care. It doesn't link up into third sector. All of that, you know, and we need that. So that to me is it might be, you know, when we discuss IT platforms, it's incredibly boring, but probably incredibly important as a first step. I don't know where we are with that within the government.
I mean, I actually find it incredibly interesting, and maybe I'm in a minority in all of that. Yeah, Brian Whittle, I am perhaps in the minority in that, but it is genuinely interesting. Data. We have a plethora of data. We have lots of data, and I know that's Cabinet Secretary for Health. I get reams of it regularly. But is it joined up in the way that I'd want it to be? Absolutely not. And that is why our recently published digital health and care strategy, which I really commend to Brian Whittle. You may already have seen it, but any member that hasn't seen it, I would really commend it to them to see, and it's available online. And I was just looking at it again as Brian Whittle was talking, and it's on page 8, it's 3 aims that I think are really important, and the second of the aims out of the 3 is to ensure that our health and care services have that important digital foundation that allows, and I'm reading from the strategy here, allows access and the ability to share relevant information across health and care systems. And care is really important in that as well. And it's not necessarily about uprooting every digital system we have. That's almost an old school way of thinking of it. But again, in page 18 of the strategy, it goes into more detail about how we create the cloud infrastructure that allows that data sharing to happen. So we don't have to append every single digital IT infrastructure that we have across primary care, various different health boards, etc., etc. What we can do is create that cloud infrastructure that allows for that greater sharing of data. But we've got to do it. How we do that with the third sector and those that are external to health and care, again, my direction to my digital team And this is a cross-government, actually, approach, is, of course, we have to be mindful and align with the various different frameworks and obligations around data and data protection. But we should be there should be no artificial barriers that are put up in the way in terms of the sharing of that data with the third sector where appropriate. So there's still work to do in that, but I would commend the digital health and care strategy for those that haven't had the chance to look at it, and it goes into a fair bit of detail on our ambitions in that regard.
Probably should declare an interest in that. I was a director of a healthcare tech company that did collaboration communication platforms before coming in here. So the actual technology is not new, it's available. And, yeah. And what you described, your Cabinet Secretary, of your reset and everything is not, it's about to be able to suck that data into a central yeah. platform. And that data to be able to talk to each other, and how you then the output from that data. Yeah. And I think what I'm suggesting to you, and what we talked about last time as well, is that you don't have an IT system currently that can do that. And that really should be, if we're going to move forward with what we're discussing here, that is something that needs to be addressed. And I'm happy to discuss that with you, Cabinet Secretary, offline.
Happy to do that. Again, certainly you've seen the strategy, but the page 18 of that talks about that national digital platform, and again, it's not a single product, as you rightly and correctly understand and say, but that kind of collaborative, integrated approach to delivering that cloud-based digital components, and that will allow us to share data in a way that we perhaps just haven't been able to do thus far. But yes, more than happy to take that discussion off table if you wish.
Happy with that.
Thank you. Can we move to John Mason, please?
Thanks very much, convener. We've touched on a number of issues already. I mean, clearly, as has been said, this week is maybe one of the worst weeks, and the hospitals seem to be absolutely full. But again, some of the evidence we've been having is that non-COVID conditions, have really suffered over the last 2 years. So I suppose my question is, should our focus really now be moving from COVID to these non-COVID conditions? Or maybe has that already happened? Or is that really still to happen in the future?
Jason may want to come in on this too, but I don't see them as binary, and I never have, in that we know that, for example, a number of people that are in hospital with COVID may have been there for other reasons and then caught COVID. We also know that COVID can exacerbate some of those underlying health conditions that people already have, whether that's respiratory, diabetes or any other condition. So I don't think we can say, look, let's stop focusing on COVID and let's focus on some of these other conditions. It's also ultimately true that the pressures that we're facing would be significantly diminished when we are able to control COVID. 2,000 COVID patients, although that might seem relatively in the grand scheme of things in terms of how many COVID how many beds we have in our hospitals might seem like a small enough number. It's all the IPC that goes around those COVID patients, which of course add a significant pressure to the health service. Of course, if community transmission is high, as it is at the moment, then of course we tend to have higher levels of staff absences too in our health and social care system. And our delayed discharges increase because, as I've already mentioned, we're not able to discharge people into care homes, or certainly the ability to discharge people into care homes is severely diminished where there's increased outbreaks and so on and so forth. So controlling COVID is really essential to help us to recover for those non-COVID conditions that John Mason mentions. At the same time, we are putting a focus on non-COVID conditions. So before I was Health Secretary, for example, launch of the cancer plan backed by £114.5 million. When I came into post, we saw the rollout of the early cancer diagnostic centres, for example. We've recently launched the urology in endoscopy and urology plan. So we are looking to recover absolutely in terms of non-COVID, but I don't see it as binary in terms of shifting focus away. The real challenge to which we haven't been able to quite crack the answer to yet is we know this probably isn't going to be the last wave of COVID, probably not even the last variant of concern in relation to COVID. And therefore, when we have these waves, how do we protect those non-COVID diagnosis, treatment, the electives, the unscheduled care that is non-COVID, how do we protect that while still hoping to manage and treat COVID? And part of that has to be some of the work that we're doing in around hospital at home, and one of those pathways being the COVID pathway, and then how can we treat people with antivirals at home as opposed to having to admit them into hospital. So there's probably a lot in that, but I don't know, Jason.
Could you just pick up on one point before I come to Jason Leach, if I may? You talked about staff absences, and clearly that's been a problem, certainly in health service and elsewhere. I mean, are there changing rules in the coming weeks that there'll be, you know, less need for isolation? Because I assume some of the staff absences are people who have either tested positive but have absolutely no symptoms, or have family members, and so they're having to stay at home. Do you anticipate that improving in the short term?
So remember, one thing the First Minister announced really clearly was that testing for health and social care staff will remain, and the asymptomatic testing route for health and social care staff will remain. So that's not changing, as one of that is something that the First Minister made clear. Will the testing, as we move from the transition phase into the steady state, as I think we're describing it, will that potentially have an impact on staff absences? Potentially, but the biggest impact really will be if we can control transmission. The more we can control community transmission, mm-hmm. the more of an impact that is going to have, clearly, on that issue of staff absences. And staff absences, if you look at the general number of staff absences, they sometimes mask some of the detail. If we look at staff absences, not just related to COVID, but actually for those who are testing positive themselves, we've seen, unfortunately, as within the community, it rises in the last few weeks that have caused or exacerbated that pressure we've already felt.
Okay, professionally.
So one of the advantages of opening up a little is I've been able to get back to the health and social care system. I'm not sure the health and social care system think it's an advantage, but I've spent the beginning of this week in Tayside and Grampian visiting and meeting those and thanking those who have led us through this. It isn't as straightforward as moving from COVID to non-COVID. I wish it were. I wish we could switch it off. The Cabinet Secretary is right. The fundamental change is we need to get prevalence down. And with the eye of faith, it may be beginning to flatten just a little. We're a few weeks behind Northern Ireland, and Northern Ireland is on a downward slope. We've no reason to believe we will be any different. England and Wales are on an upward slope. They're a bit behind us, and I think they will have exactly the same pattern with BA2 as us. I saw health and social care staff, third sector organisations working hard to fix anything that turns up, frankly, in shorthand. But COVID makes all of that more complicated. Mm. You don't want COVID to spread from that one individual to the four-bedded bay in Nine Wells Hospital that's 50 years old. Pieces of Grampian, much, much older than that, where patients have to be cohorted if they're contacts or if they're positive. So COVID makes hand surgery more difficult, even if it's not to do with the hand surgery. I happened to meet some hand surgery patients when I was there. So everything is about getting that infectious disease prevalence down. And that would be true if it was norovirus. It would be true if it was flu. We just have this new version. I did see really encouraging signs of pressure beginning to come off, particularly critical care. Critical care was kind of back to its normal footprint. Last time I was there, it was three times as big. Now it's back to its normal size. It's full, but it's full of post-op care, strokes, and occasional COVID patients. So it definitely feels different. And the staff, the clinical teams, are transitioning to that more common way of working. But we don't have slack. And the only other thing I would add, apart from absence, is they're tired. They're looking forward to time off at Easter or the summer, because they've worked for 2.5 years without a break, many of them. So we need to just be careful not to overload what is already a fragile community who have saved tens of thousands of lives over the last 2 years. They were enthusiastic. They were still smiling. They were maybe I only met those ones, but they were terrific. But I was conscious that we've asked a lot of them. I met a care home manager who slept in her care home for 3 weeks after 7 deaths in a care home earlier in a previous wave. I mean, she's keen to keep going. She wants to keep going, but we've got to give them time to recover.
Okay. I mean, moving on, in response to Murdo Fraser's question, there was, I think, dentistry was mentioned and a few other things. So, I mean, clearly this kind of recovery is different across the board, and dentistry does seem to be one. I have not seen my dentist for over 2 years I have chipped my teeth in that time, but fortunately without a lot of pain or anything. I mean, let's take dentistry then. Where's that going? How soon can we get back to the 6 monthly appointments? Is it just a case of a practice by practice and it's entirely up to them? And I mean, ultimately, you know, should I dislike the idea of going to a private dentist, but I mean, would that be the advice to take pressure off the NHS? Mm-hmm.
No, it's not. It's not the advice that we're giving. There's no doubt that dentistry has been hit hard as a sector for all the reasons that I mentioned before. My response to Murdo Fraser, particularly given the aerosol generating procedures that they have to carry out, but we are seeing dentists open up. We are seeing them take the appropriate precautions. We have provided support and funding in relation to ventilation. There's drills that they can use that mitigate against those the effects of aerosol generating procedures. That again, we're grant funding for dental practices. And what we are doing is through essentially a multiplier, we are going to be rewarding dentists who do more NHS activity, because we had a good debate in the Parliament actually about dentistry. Yeah. Recently, we heard some concerning stories, and I'm sure it is just a minority, of course, but we heard some concerning stories of dentists upselling private plans to their patients, and that's not allowed within the regulations, of course, but also is deeply unethical. And so what we're doing through our funding arrangements will be to reward those who see more and more NHS patients. So we will recover. Why I couldn't give you an exact date and time in terms of when that recovery will be complete is because, as we've just discussed, we are still in the midst of this pandemic. And until we get to pre-pandemic levels of activity, and this is true for right across the health service, then we're going to continue, I'm afraid, to see that backlog increase. It's only once we get to pre-COVID levels, or I hope above pre-COVID levels, do we begin to see that backlog begin to reduce. But being still in the midst of a global pandemic, it is difficult to put an absolute date on when we think that recovery will be complete.
Because, I mean, just to wind this up, convener, I mean, I've had more people on at me, more constituents, about not having access to a dentist than I have had not having access to a GP, for example, or I think any other service probably. And we say to people, well, you know, if you can't get dentists in Bayliston, what about trying ones in Shelston? But people are saying, no, I've tried all the dentists in the area and none of them will take me. What should I say to these constituents?
Well, I think you should say that through the government's funding arrangements, we will see a step change. I'm certain about that. Now, dentists will still have to operate within the IPC constraints, so they will not be able to see as many people as they saw pre-pandemic. But we are beginning to see activity levels. We were beginning, pre-Omicron, beginning to see activity levels rise within dental practices. I think the new funding arrangements that incentivise and reward NHS activity will begin to see even more. Maybe worth bringing in Professor Leach, given his expertise in dentistry, in particular, if he's got anything to add to that.
Tom, I think dentistry is one of the best examples of why this is so hard, because the dental procedures cause a particular risk around COVID and COVID patients. And my colleagues, I went to the dental school earlier this week in Dundee and met new students who are now working in an entirely different environment with little pods where we can protect them from the AGP and the patients. I met a patient who'd been coming to that dental hospital since 1964 and was on his 40th student doing his checkups every year. It was fantastic. Again, full of enthusiasm, but doing it within the constraints which we've set for them. This is slightly easier for an advisor to say than a politician. Dentistry and optometry are a mixed model in this country. They are not free at the point of delivery for every single member of the population. That's been a decision that governments have made for 70 years. So there is a mixed model, but if you're an NHS patient and you want NHS treatment, that should be available to you. That's not the same as saying it's there isn't private available for you, or independent rather than very expensive private. There are really three layers of dental funding. There's the NHS layer. There's then what a lot of people do is the insurance system, where you might pay £25 a month and get X care. And then there's very high-end private that you would get in Harley Street or you would get in Glasgow or Edinburgh. So that mixed model is available to people. But the NHS model, which has had to adapt over the last 2 years, is now coming back. My colleagues who are in it are saying they are beginning to see an increase, partly because the tech has changed, so we're now able to give them new technology, and because the funding streams are now adjusted. So my advice to your constituents would be to be just a little bit more patient. And if that doesn't fix itself in the next 6 months, then they should come back and ask again.
Thank you. Can I bring in Jim Fairley?
Convener. Good morning, gentlemen. I'm going to refer back to Murdo Fraser's original question in terms of the access to GPs and the hybrid modelling. We took evidence, and I really apologise, I can't remember which lady it was that said it, because I asked that same question of witnesses last week, and should we be giving people the understanding that hybrid modelling will be the way you're going to see your GP in the future? And a response I found really interesting was that, well, that will very much depend on how the patients accept that, or worse to that effect. So is there a, you're saying that hybrid modelling will be the normal way that we're going to proceed. So is there a messaging job that the Scottish Government has to do to let people understand that that hybrid will be the way forward, and how do you put their mind at ease that this is the way they're going to be seen going forward?
Yeah, I think there is a need for communication, and again, in your previous evidence sessions, I think it was Dr. Shackles who said that there needs to be this kind of open, honest conversation with the public. And if it wasn't him, I'm obviously happy to create the record, but it was certainly one of the clinicians that was giving you evidence talked about that open, honest conversation that was needing to hear this from clinicians day in and day out, time and time again. I do my best to be very upfront about the fact that this recovery is not something that's going to take weeks or months, it's going to take years. And I think people have come to accept that and the reasons for that. What I would say is we did actually have a hybrid model pre-pandemic too. There was the ability to use telephone consultation, video consultation near me existed pre-pandemic, used nowhere near to the scale it's being used in the course of the pandemic. So I think there's a balance here. My direction and actually recovery plan spells this out, is to increase face-to-face access to GPs, because we know that there are issues around potentially digital exclusion, and we've got to work hard to narrow that digital exclusion gap right down and eliminate it altogether. We know that for particular constituents that we represent, again, I'm not overgeneralising, I hope, but particularly older constituents, they may want to see their GP face-to-face. Then it's really important that access for face-to-face, where it is clinically appropriate, should be happening. And of course, where people wish to see their GP face-to-face, and again, it's clinically appropriate, that should be happening. But we have to also, continue to invest in the telephone and the video consultation facilities that are available. And going back to the question that Brian Whittle asked me earlier on, there's something about how we access our NHS and healthcare and social care through digital, which is going to increase. And there's good pilots around how we're doing that. I think we need to probably upscale those.
Okay. I know there's an inquiry into excess deaths, but Jason, you touched on it earlier on. Staff are exhausted. People are very tired. And one of the things that we have had as a recurring theme is this feeling from GPs that they are being blamed for a lot of the early diagnosis is not happening. A lot of the problems that we see as a result of COVID, GPs are feeling a lot of the pressure of that. And we need to rebuild or make sure that that trust and that relationship with the public is still there. But one of the other things that we were told last week was that there are GPs who are being incentivised to retire early than they might have done because there's existing pensions and tax arrangements. Now, I know that I'm kind of going off piste here a wee bit, but we can't deliver good healthcare if we don't have a comfortable, well-paid staff who want to be there and want to do the best that they can. But if they're at that feeling of, I'm not enjoying this anymore, then the healthcare system suffers. So specifically, we can go through everybody's, you know, we can go through nurses, porters, doctors, we can go through everybody's, but this is a specific issue that has been raised with the committee. So I know that the Scottish Government have looked at this, and spoke to the UK Government before about this. what progress have you made, or has anything happened in terms of this incentivising GPs to come to retire early?
So, a few points I'd make. There's not been any progress on the issue that I raised with the UK government. And, you know, again, I always thought it would be a long shot given the financial pressures that everybody is under. But that being said, I would still continue to pursue where there's possible pension changes that can be made that help with retention, then I'll continue to do that, and I've given that commitment to the BMA. The BMA have also rightly challenged the Scottish Government and said, well, what more can you do in this space? And they've asked, for example, for me to give active consideration to a recycling employers contribution scheme, a REC scheme, and the ability for health boards to activate a REC scheme if it's in their interest to do so. So I've said that's under active consideration, and it continues to be under active consideration. But I go back to the point that Jason made, I think, in this, that of course we have to deal with any financial disincentives that might be in the system. But, you know, if we can control COVID, when we control COVID, we will control it. When we begin to recover in a managed and staged way, we've got to do that in a way that does not exhaust an already, frankly, knackered workforce. And in the GP practice, that's not just the GP, although, of course, they are knackered. It is the multidisciplinary team. It is the receptionist who often, again, is the first person that people, will always be the first person that people no doubt talk to, who tell me that they've had increases of abuse over the phone and in person. It's really making sure that they are well taken care of and their well-being is taken care of. So we've invested record levels, actually, in the well-being of NHS and social care staff, and we'll continue to make that investment. So, yes, we'll do what we can to rid the system of financial disincentives, and we'll actively consider that. We'll make sure they are well paid, and, you know, you'd expect me to say this and reiterate this point, of course, we have the best paid staff and NHS staff in the UK. But we'll also make sure that we do what we can to retain them. And if you look at the recently published workforce strategy, there's a whole section in there. In fact, it's a thread throughout the entire strategy around nurture, and that looks at the well-being and the retention that needs to be in place in order to help with the recovery. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Only that this has been a challenge for the higher end of the health service employees in salary terms for years now, dentists and doctors in particular, but also some healthcare managers who are in the NHS pension scheme that has been controversial between the devolved administrations and the UK government, and the Cabinet Secretary continues to make that point in meetings. I mean, it does need resolved, and the BMA have been very, very forceful in asking principally the UK government to resolve it, because much of the power is reserved, but also asking the other three governments as well to do what they can. It's quite a hard message to sell for the highest paid members of our service, but if the option is that they will then leave and retire at 57, then we really need them to stay. It's about lifetime allowance and coming back and effectively doing the work for free, because you're having to pay 80%, 75% tax on what you continue to earn. So yeah, I know you. There's some around the country who won't have a huge amount of sympathy for that level of pay, but we need to retain them.
Yeah, I understand that there might not be a huge amount of sympathy, but it takes 10 years to get a GP up
Correct.
To that level of standard. Right. We don't want them leaving the service 10 years sooner than they might otherwise have
and
done.
And they may be the GP on Barra, or the GP in Elgin, and they're very difficult to recruit to. So yeah. I agree with you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I'm conscious that the Cabinet Secretary has to leave at 10:15, but can I bring in Murdo and then Alex Rowley?
Thank you, Convener. I'd just like to pick up an issue I don't think we've really touched on much this morning. That's the issue of emergency medicine. Because some of the most striking evidence we heard in this committee was from the Royal College of Emergency Medicine, who told us that in 2021 there had been 500 excess deaths related to people accessing emergency treatment too late. So that's 10 people per week dying, either because the ambulance doesn't turn up in time, or because it does, but the ambulance then gets to the hospital and can't get its patients out from the ambulance into the emergency ward in time. And that was really striking. And one of the issues they highlighted was the ongoing issue with workforce and lack of capacity. So I know, Cabinet Secretary, you announced on Friday a new national workforce strategy, and I was interested to see the press comment yesterday that the Royal College made on this, whilst welcoming the strategy, saying they were disappointed not to have been consulted on the strategy and by the limited mentions of urgent and emergency care. So will you be meeting the Royal College to discuss this and taking on board their real concerns in this area?
Surprised by the comment, because I obviously meet with the Royal College of Emergency Medicine regularly, and I think it was Dr. Thompson, wasn't it, that was giving you evidence, and I've met with Dr. Thompson on past occasion, and actually those meetings helped inform our strategy, and that's why no doubt he did welcome the strategy, because a lot of the issues that they raised with me are core components. But of course, the strategy, as we say in the document, is an iterative document. It will continue to develop and evolve as we make our way through this pandemic and hopefully well into recovery. So, of course, I'll meet with the RCM as I tend to do fairly regularly. And we did have some consultation with a number of stakeholders. The RCM, I take on board what they said yesterday, so they can be absolutely assured that I'll be keen to meet with them fairly early doors to get their further thoughts on our workforce strategy.
Okay. And can just one brief follow-up, I mean, can you give us a sense of where we are now with this issue of delays with ambulances? Because clearly there's a lot of pressure right now on the NHS, on emergency wards. Are we still seeing these issues happening today?
Yes, it goes back to what I said, I'm happy to state this on the record, that my conversations and my officials' conversations with health boards this week, they are saying to us that this feels like the worst week of the pandemic, potentially, if not the worst, and certainly amongst the worst weeks of the pandemic. And it's an accumulation of factors that, again, I've already spoken about. And I met with the Scottish Ambulance Service yesterday with Pauline Howie and Tom Steele, the Chief Executive and the Chair of the Scottish Ambulance Service, and they again said that they are under severe pressure, because we know the knock-on, and I won't go into detail. In fact, I think Murdo Fraser, from my previous reading of evidence sessions, has raised the issue of ambulance waiting times at hospitals and turnaround times at hospitals. So we're seeing those play out this week. My hope, of course, is... Well, much my hope. I mean, we are working to try to alleviate as much of that pressure as we possibly can, while at the same time realising that the current peak we're in is, as Professor Leach rightly says, that we will get through that peak. But it is about how do we insulate our health services, including emergency medicine, how do we insulate that work when we have a future peak? And that's something that we're working hard on as much as we possibly can. But this is a very challenging time at the moment.
Okay.
Thank you. Can I ask the question about the redesign of urgent care? I read an article this morning that suggested that £40 million had been spent on that, and that the results were not great, and that you've now commissioned consultants at a cost of £84,180 to review that redesign of urgent care. So could you tell us where that's at and what you think is working and not?
Well, I think there's been some positives around the redesign of urgent care. And look, if any programme is needed now during this course of the pandemic and into recovery, it's the redesign of urgent care. But I don't think it's unusual for government to take feedback in terms of whether what areas of any programme can be improved and take some advice on whether or not it needs readjusted or whether it needs, as I say, improved. So we are implementing the redesign of urgent care programme. It's supported by significant investment, and we've seen, for example, you know, a hub being established in every health board to directly receive referrals from NHS 24, offering rapid access to senior clinicians using telephone or video consultation where possible. That minimises the need to attend A&E. So we've seen good innovation. But we certainly are never against seeing how we can further improve programmes, and redesign of urgent care is certainly one of them.
But given that you've spent £40 million, is the result delivering what the government expects?
Well, we've certainly seen a positive impact. We've certainly seen a positive impact, but it's so difficult to judge that in the period in the course of the pandemic. But the redesign of urgent care programme is going to be really vital to our recovery. We are going to have to reduce the demand on acute. Redesign of urgent care will help with that. The hospital at home work we're doing with that. The issues that Alex Rowley has already raised around social care will help with that. We are going to have to reduce that demand. And as I say, the redesign of urgent care programme has helped to an extent. But I've got no doubt that we should consider what additional improvements could be made to that programme.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes our consideration of this agenda item and our time with the Cabinet Secretary. I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary and his supporting official for their attendance this morning. I will now briefly suspend the meeting to allow a changeover of witnesses. Thank you. Okay. Good morning. I'd like to welcome the Deputy First Minister to the meeting and his supporting officials, Professor Jason Leach, National Clinical Director, Greg Walker, Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill Team Leader, Elizabeth Blair, Unit Head for COVID Coordination, and joining us online is Stuart Cunningham, lawyer from the Scottish Government. Welcome. Members will see that the Minister for Parliamentary Business has written to the committee following the First Minister's statement on Tuesday. The Minister explains in his letter which legislation the Scottish Government is revoking in light of the statement. I draw this letter to the attention of members as these changes affect the secondary legislation on our agenda today. Deputy First Minister, would you like to make any brief opening remarks before we move to questions, please?
Thank you, Convener. I'm grateful to the committee for the opportunity to discuss a number of matters, including updates to Parliament on COVID-19. As the First Minister set out on Tuesday, there has been a recent increase in cases driven by the BA2 sublineage of the Omicron variant. It is now the dominant strain in Scotland, accounting for more than 80% of all reported cases. Encouragingly, there is no evidence that BA2 causes more severe illness than BA1 or that it is more effective at evading natural or vaccine immunity. We continue to observe strong evidence that the link between infection and serious health harm has weakened considerably due to immune protection. Therefore, extension of the vaccination programme is ongoing in line with GCVI advice. Letters inviting 5 to 11-year-olds not in higher risk groups for vaccination started arriving at the end of last week, and booster jabs for older adults in care homes also started last week. Additional boosters for those who are immunosuppressed will start from mid-April. As the First Minister announced from Friday, and in line with other UK nations, all remaining COVID-related travel restrictions will be lifted. While we do have some concerns about this, UK travel patterns mean that diverging from the rest of the UK would cause economic disadvantage without delivering any meaningful public health benefit. From Monday, the 21st of March, with one temporary exception, the remaining domestic legal measures will be lifted and replaced with appropriate guidance. That means on Monday, the requirement on businesses and service providers to retain customer contact details will end, and so too will the requirement for businesses, places of worship and service providers to have regard to Scottish Government guidance on COVID and to take reasonably practicable measures set out in the guidance. The exception relates to the requirement to wear face coverings on public transport and in certain indoor settings. Given the current spike in case numbers, continued widespread use of face coverings will provide some additional protection, particularly for the most vulnerable at a time when the risk of infection is very high, and it may help us to get over this spike more quickly. We will review it again in 2 weeks' time. The other issue the First Minister covered on Tuesday was testing. For the next month until Easter, there will be no change to our testing advice. However, from the 18th of April, and with the exception of health and care settings, we will no longer advise people without symptoms to test twice weekly. From the end of April, all routine population-wide testing will end. And from the 1st of May, instead of a population-wide approach, we will use testing on a targeted basis. This marks steady progress back towards normal life and a more sustainable way of managing the virus. We will do everything we can to support those who have worked on the testing programme during the transition. I want to echo the First Minister's gratitude and thank all of them for their invaluable contribution over the last 2 years. And I'm very happy to answer questions from the committee.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. If I can now turn to questions, and if I may begin by asking the first question. With numbers still high in Scotland, and we've just had the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care say that this week could be one of the worst weeks for the NHS with pressure on the NHS. Concerns been raised in relation to the reduced funding for certain COVID-19 related studies and data collection from the end of March, including the Zoe COVID symptom study, the Siren and the Vivaldi studies, which monitor infections in health workers and in care homes. Dr. Stephen Griffin, who's a virologist at the University of Leeds, said the decisions by the UK government on COVID surveillance would slow the country's ability to respond and adjust to future waves, surges of infections or new variants as well. Can I ask the Deputy First Minister if he feels comfortable with the UK's current approach?
I think this is a challenging issue and a sensitive issue. And I'll invite Professor Leach to add some comments to what I'm going to say to begin with. We must have in place adequate surveillance measures at two levels to ensure that we have knowledge of what is the emerging situation. The two levels are essentially at a population-wide level. I think it would be difficult to justify on a persistent long-term basis the type of intense testing arrangements that we have had in place at a population-wide level, but we need to have some population-wide information. So a high-quality ONS infection survey combined with the data that we collect from wastewater, for example, gives us at a population-wide level, we believe, a sufficiently strong base of information to be able to assess what I might describe as the generality of the position on prevalence of COVID within our society. There's then a second element that is important, which is our contribution, which is the same as the contribution of other countries around the globe, to developing the understanding and the appreciation and the detection, understanding and appreciation of any new variants that may emerge. So we must be able to continue to do a sufficient level of testing within the population to enable us to identify any variants that are emerging in the way that the testing approach that was taken forward in southern Africa identified the Omicron variant, which was then identified in a number of other jurisdictions very quickly, and we were alerted to that and were able to respond as swiftly as we were. Now, why does that matter? Well, that matters because, as I've rehearsed with this committee before, we took decisions very quickly to tackle the situation we faced in relation to Omicron. If we had not done so, I am pretty certain the National Health Service would have got into very deep difficulties. We averted that because of the speed of our action. I know our actions were controversial. I know they did not command universal support. But the alternative would have been to see our National Health Service overtopped. And so that intelligence of new variants is critical in enabling governments to respond appropriately. So I hope that gives us... I don't know if Professor Leach wants to add to what...
Only that I think your question is crucial. It partly allows me to deflect between advice and solution. So it's one of these times where we have given very strong advice that the UK as a whole needs to continue to do three things. It needs to do surveillance, which is what the Deputy First Minister has described, and that surveillance has to include genetic testing. It has to do research on the course of the disease. That's what SIREN has done for us. SIREN, for those of you who don't know, is health and social care workers who get the disease and we follow them over a long period to check their immunity, to check their long COVID status. So we need to continue to monitor the course of the disease and we need to monitor treatment for the disease. And that's what Recovery and Panoramic have done. Panoramic in particular relies on testing of the population because you need to know if you can join the Panoramic study if you're positive or negative. If we stop testing, Panoramic will have to find a new way of finding patients in order to enrol them to get the treatment to see if the treatment works. So from a public health perspective, we require to continue to do those three things. And the world requires to continue to do those three things. Now, of course, it will evolve over time. We don't do flu testing when you brush your teeth. So we have to change it over time, but we need to continue to do those three things. And we will give advice, as we have done to the Deputy First Minister and others, as we have done to the UK government, to tell them that we need to continue to do those three sections in order for us to help the population live with this disease.
Thank you for your answers. If I could just ask one other question, and this is in relation to some test and protect staff that have been in touch in the last couple of days who have been working for the last 18 months, and they feel from the announcement last Tuesday, a bit like a kick in the teeth. And forgive me if this is the wrong information, but the information relayed from them is that they've been told by the health boards that there was funding in place for test and protect up until September. So I think there was an assumption that they would be in these roles until September and not out of a job in April. Could you give any clarity on that or with the funding options?
I think there would always be judgments to be made about the longevity of the testing arrangements And obviously there is financial provision in the budget for 2022-23 which enables some testing activity to be undertaken. I would have to clarify, because obviously this would be an internal health portfolio transaction and advice, any specific guidance that was previously given to health boards about that point. So I better write to the committee specifically about that point. But I wouldn't imagine that it was likely that specific commitments had been given to that extent or to that degree of specificity. There may have been commitments given about there would be a need for an ongoing approach to testing. I wouldn't be at all surprised by that. But I will check, convener, and write to you accordingly to provide clarity on that point.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Can I bring in Murdo Fraser?
Thank you, convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and colleagues. I'd like to ask a couple of questions about the vaccination programme. In the earlier session, Professor Leach highlighted the recent report in The Lancet, which was very significant in terms of highlighting the importance of the vaccination programme in terms of suppressing the virus. There's a report in the Scotsman newspaper this morning stating that 27,000 doses of vaccine were thrown away in February after fewer people than expected came forward for a vaccination. I wonder if that's an accurate report, and if it is accurate, is that something that should concern us? Are we seeing a drop-off in people coming forward for vaccination?
There will always be a degree of, I suppose there's no better word than waste in the vaccination programme. I think we all accept that. Ministers have been very clear that we want to minimise that. If my memory serves me right, I think the vaccination programme commenced with an assumption that there may be as much as 5% waste in the programme, but the practical reality of that throughout, I think, has been less than 1% of waste within the vaccination programme. So I think in terms of performance against expectation, I think that's a very good performance. I think the detail of that news report, I'd have to check. But obviously, we are endeavouring to ensure that we maximise the participation in the vaccination programme. Why do we do that? Well, we do that because vaccination is the absolute key to minimising the harm that comes from COVID. I think if there's one thing that concerns me about the narrative of discussion around about in recent weeks about COVID, and particularly about Omicron, is that there has been a suggestion in the narrative that Omicron has been a milder variant than previous variants. I actually think that's the wrong way to look at this. I think what we are seeing is the protection of the vaccination programme giving us a lot more protection against, it happens to be called Omicron, but there are numerous cases of people who have the Omicron variant but have faced very severe health consequences because they have been unvaccinated. So I think we've got to be careful that we undervalue the impact of the vaccination programme, because the vaccination programme is crucial in actually tackling the effect of COVID, whether it's Omicron or whatever, because there are fellow citizens of ours who are having a very hard time with Omicron, but in many cases because they are unvaccinated. So the strength of arguments in support of vaccination are absolutely overwhelming in my view, and they are used by the government to encourage the uptake of vaccination. And I suppose there's one final point I would add, which is that the more we get into a sense that the worst of COVID is past us, there might be a sense that maybe people don't need to get vaccinated. And I would take entirely the opposite view to that, that it's vaccination that's giving us the protection against COVID that people need.
Thank you for that response. But
I think Professor Leach...
Oh, sorry. Professor only Leach. To add some... Yeah. Exactly as you would expect me to do, I'm going to take your 27,000 and raise it by the number that I've actually been given. So I'm going to add some context to your question, which is in January we gave 472,000 doses and in February we gave 184,000 doses. Once you take the Pfizer vial out the freezer, you have to use it in 12 hours or you have to throw it away. So as numbers go down a little, as we get some of the stragglers rather than the 75,000 a day we were doing before Christmas, inevitably you end up with some marginal differences, in particularly in small vaccination centres where you maybe can't use all of your doses. So we have at the beginning said 5%. We're still way, way below 5%. Nobody wants to throw out any vaccine, particularly the vaccinators. And it just indicates that we're in a phase where we are getting a group that are slightly harder to persuade to come because we've done the massive bulk. As we go into the over 75s now, which is a big chunk again, and the youngsters, a big chunk again, I would anticipate that waste falling even further.
So the top line on this story this morning is that fewer people have come forward than expected for vaccination. Is that correct or not?
No, I don't think that's fair. I think it's an extrapolation from a waste piece of data into a number coming forward. We don't take them out the freezer unless we know they're in the room. So if you've got one or two, you have to take the vial out the freezer and the vial has to defrost. So you've got to think about that before you come. So you might take it out if you've got appointments for 100, take out enough vials for 100, and then you only get 80 people turning up. And if you multiply that up over a month and over a period, you get to 27,000 relatively quickly because there's six doses in a vial. So I don't think we've seen anything dropping off more than we thought. We always knew that after the big push for New Year, we were going to see a drop off now. That doesn't mean I don't want everybody to come.
Yeah. Can I ask a specific follow-up, which arises from a constituent case? I've got a constituent who had an adverse reaction to the second dose of the vaccine. Quite a serious adverse reaction. I know this is rare, but it does happen. And he then went to his GP, and his GP advised him not to get the booster. Now, his concern, therefore, is if he's required at some point in future to provide certification of full vaccination status, he needs to get an exemption. He then applied for an exemption and was told that he was not eligible for one. But nobody spoke to his GP, nobody asked to see his medical records. So he's now left in a limbo where his GP is telling him he shouldn't get a booster, but he's not entitled to get an exemption. So where do we go from here?
I think where we go from there is, I think what we... what ministers have made clear to Parliament on countless occasions about certification issues is that Mr. Fraser's welcome to write to me and I'll see there's a resolution to the particular...
Well, I did write to Mr. Swinney and I got your reply last month and you've given me two pages of very general advice, but it doesn't address a specific issue where this man's GP is telling him, do not get a booster. He's being told by the NHS, sorry, you're not eligible for an exemption, but they're not asking to see the medical records. I'm slightly confused how somebody can reach that conclusion as to his personal circumstances without liaising with his GP.
Well, I'm happy to look at that and see exactly how it can be resolved, because we do face... sometimes competing medical opinions about what's the right thing to do. So, I'm not going to sit here and give clinical advice, but I'll certainly make sure it can be addressed.
OK, I'll write to you again. Thank you. I've got one more question, if I may, if we've got time. On an entirely different topic, and that's to do with care homes. Now, we've seen restrictions lifted on visiting care homes. That's very welcome. Again, a constituent contacted me to say she has an elderly relative in a care home. If a member of staff tests positive in the care home, then the entire care home is locked down. Residents are not allowed to leave their rooms, to go into common areas. That's very distressing for residents who've already had to put up with 2 years of isolation. It happens with some frequency because of the high level of incidence of COVID. As far as I can tell, this is not something that's set in government regulation. But it'd be helpful if you just confirm that and were able to tell us, is there any advice being offered to operators of care homes around these types of issues?
That's not the government guidance. Although there is quite a lot of risk assessment done by local care homes, and care homes all look very different. Some are Georgian houses and some are very modern establishments. So we have to be generic and give some power to the care home managers to make those choices. But if you, again, if you contact us about that specific care home, I'll make sure somebody gets in touch to make sure they are familiar with the most recent guidance. The guidance will also be being redone in light of the announcements on Tuesday, particularly around testing for staff and for residents. And that will, we hope, allow a further relaxation of some of the protections. These are our most vulnerable citizens, so we have to be cautious. But there are other harms within there that you illustrate, of being locked in rooms, of being not able to use communal facilities if there's a positive case, and we're hoping to relax some of that. So that individual care home is not following the national guidance, but there may be good reason for their particular environment for that. But let's get in touch with them just to make sure we're doing all we can.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Alex Riley, please.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Good morning. Firstly, I agree with the Deputy First Minister in terms of the staff, the testing staff. I have certainly been for a few tests where winter weather in car parks in Dunfermline and Cowdenbeath, and these people have worked through it all. So they do deserve our absolute gratitude and thank you. So given that we're going to scale this back, how many people are involved in terms of these staff? And is the government saying to health boards to actually start to look at a programme that would give people the opportunity? We know we've got staffing shortages right across the economy. We've certainly got tons of staffing shortages within social care and the NHS. So is there opportunities being put in place? And is there actually a programme that says these people have given their all over these last year or two? We're going to work with them and we're going to actually look at getting them into other posts. Is there a plan in place for that?
There is, of course, there's a number of channels in place around through which the testing programme is delivered. Some of the testing is delivered under the auspices of the National Health Service in Scotland. Some is delivered through the Test and Protect infrastructure put in place by the United Kingdom government and its contractors. So obviously there are different employment relationships in there that will be affected. You know, we've, for example, the National Health Service in Scotland turned over substantial proportions of the lab testing environment within the National Health Service in Scotland to the purposes of COVID. So there will be ways in which that will be redeployed to other purposes. So there will be different ways of approaching this. I think the key point is, and this is where I would agree with Mr. Rowley and would want to assure him, that we do have shortages of staff in a range of different areas within the health and social care system. These individuals who have been involved in testing have been substantially involved in that area of activity. So it would seem a natural approach to make sure that they are able to have access to the recruitment opportunities within the National Health Service and the appropriate training opportunities that exist as well. So that will be very much taken forward by individual health boards, all of whom have in place recruitment strategies to try to fill the vacancies that they have at different levels of activity within the health service.
Because that would lead me to my next question, which I actually asked the Health Secretary earlier about. The evidence we've been taking, not just this last couple of weeks, but in this last couple of weeks, we've had third sector organisations say that joined up working can be a bit of a hit or a miss. And some health authorities welcome them, they have an input. Others, it's just really they're there when called upon. And it just seems to me that there is a massive resource problem at this present time, but actually there's a massive resource out there between the third sector, health and social care, NHS, local government, and I'm not sure that it's all coming together. Even the GPs in previous evidence sessions, when we've asked them, is there around GP practices all these different support services, they say it's a hit or a miss. So that's a question of leadership. And whilst government's not about micromanagement, surely we have to ensure that we're getting the best from the resources that we have out there. Do you think we are?
I think Mr. Rowley tempts me into an area that has been a source of significant frustration for me for some time. I don't think the government's message could be clearer about the need for joined-up working, for person-centred activity at local level. I don't think it could be clearer. I've been banging on about it for years. It's central to the COVID recovery strategy. I wouldn't describe it as casually as hit or miss, as Mr. Rowley does, but I don't think it's perfect. No, I don't. And I think the strength of third sector contributions in some parts of the country is suitably, possibly even fully taken into account. But in other parts of the country, I don't think it is. And I don't think it's all person-centred. I think there is still an increasing amount in which members of the public are expected to join up public services, whereas it shouldn't be for members of the public to join up public services, it should be for public services to be joined up and available to members of the public to access. So these messages are absolutely central. I'm very confident that the message that Mr. Rowley seeks to put forward is being put forward by ministers. I hear it being put forward by the Health Secretary. I hear it being put forward by the Social Justice Secretary in her dialogue with local government. I certainly put it forward in my dialogue with both. Indeed, my two Cabinet colleagues, the Health Secretary and the Social Justice Secretary, and I used the opportunity of a discussion with over 200 people from the leadership of health and social care activity around the country. And the fact that 200 people had to be on the call tells its own story. The importance of ensuring that all capacity, no matter where it comes from, third sector, private sector, public sector, is woven together into a single proposition that's available for members of the public. In some parts of the country, I think that is strong. In other parts of the country, there's a distance still to be travelled.
Okay, and can I just quickly, convener, in terms of, we know we have a major problem coming our way, getting worse in terms of the cost of living crisis, the lateral flow testing, at some point that's going to cease and people are going to have to pay for it, these lateral flow tests or not?
No.
No?
No.
Okay, that's good then. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I bring in John?
Just for the absolute avoidance of the lateral flow tests will remain free of charge.
Thank you. John Mason.
Thanks so much, convener. I asked you this question at committee some time ago, Deputy First Minister, so I'm going to ask it again. Given that the numbers in hospital are 1,999 last time I looked, that is the figure I look at every day. That figure concerns me quite a lot. We heard from the Health Secretary earlier on that the hospitals are really toiling. Should we be really lifting any restrictions on Monday?
I think the there's probably two numbers that I would encourage Mr. Mason to look at. Yes, the total number in hospital with COVID, but also, as importantly, the number of new admissions week by week by comparison. And I think what those numbers, what the latter numbers, the numbers being admitted to hospital on a week by week basis, are beginning to show a reduction. I was going to say tailing off, but I don't think I could justify tailing off. But they're certainly reducing on a weekly basis, which indicates to me that we appear to be getting over the peak of the challenge that we face from BA2. So on that justification, I think we are in an appropriate place to undertake the relaxations that are taking place on Monday. But then I would also say that the government has taken the difficult decision, which I recognise is not universally popular, that one of the relaxations that was proposed for Monday is not going to be permitted, and that is the relaxation of the obligation, the legal obligation, to wear face coverings in public spaces. And we judge that that is, given where we are in this challenge, that is an appropriate and proportionate measure to extend for a further two-week period and then to review, because we feel by that time we should hopefully have clearer evidence that we are over the peak of BA2 and can more confidently take that step. But I appreciate that position is not universally supported, but I judge it to be the right decision that the government has made.
Okay, thank you. Moving on to testing, and maybe for clarification, I've got one or two points. I mean, I think testing is going to carry on if somebody maybe visits a care home and in certain circumstances. But, I mean, say I'm wanting to visit my elderly aunt, and in the past I have tested before I went to see her because I would feel she's vulnerable. That's not going to be possible for me in the future, is it?
You're certainly, if you have any lateral flow testing kits available, you'll be able to do so.
If I keep them, yes, but I won't be able to get any new ones after the end of April?
That's correct, yeah.
Yes. OK. I think I read that there's going to be 2 months of testing capacity kept in case we've got another uptake or whatever. Presumably these things go out of date after a while and will have to be thrown out. I mean, how often are we going to have to keep, or is the government going to have to keep replenishing them?
Well, there will, of course, be an element of testing that will be on going forward on an ongoing basis. So it's not that we just have all of these testing kits in a warehouse that's locked. You know, there will be a replenishment of supply to avoid exactly the situation that Mr. Mason fairly puts to me, to make sure that we're utilising the resources that we have at our disposal.
Okay, thank you. Now, the isolation grants, I think, are due to cease as well as part of the other measures. Does that mean that if anyone's got to isolate for COVID or any other reason, we go back to the other system whereby it's the health board that has financial responsibility for getting somebody to isolate?
We're looking carefully at the issues around about self-isolation grant support, because fundamentally we need to recognise the interaction here between the practical circumstances of individuals and the necessity to interrupt the circulation of the virus. And obviously the advice that will be available is encouraging people to remain at home in the way that we would do so about other conditions where people might run the risk of spreading that to other members of society. So we're looking carefully at the arrangements around self-isolation, because I do recognise the challenge that Mr. Mason raises, where it might not be financially practical and possible for individuals to be able to self-isolate without loss of income, and given points Mr. Rowley has just put to me about the cost of living crisis that people are facing, it's another dimension. So we are looking very carefully at what other arrangements can be put in place. I would stress that the arrangements under the Public Health Scotland Act 2008 are designed for very limited outbreak purposes, so they're not really suitable for the much wider proposition that's put to me in this scenario.
Okay, yes, because that was a point that came up, I think, when we looked at the legislation.
Yeah, that's right.
And my final area would be, Murdo Fraser already touched on kind of vaccinations and take-up levels, and you know, as usual, I look at some of the figures we've been given. 30 to 39-year-olds only, I think 57.6% of males have had a booster, which is quite a lot less than the older age groups. And again, obviously, I look at Glasgow and I see the lowest figure, 66.1%, having had dose 3 and the booster. Are we making any progress on these, or do we just accept it's just an ongoing challenge?
We have to persist with the message about the importance of vaccination, because, as I said in my answers to Murdo Fraser earlier, I am concerned by an attitude of mind that says, oh, Omicron is much softer variant than previous variants. I think that view is allowed to prevail because of the robustness of vaccination. And if we then don't have the robustness of vaccination, then we'll be exposed to much more serious illness, which then comes back to Mr. Mason's first question to me about hospital admissions. Because if people are more seriously ill and they spend more time in hospital, then those numbers will not come down. And our hospitals will face a problem. And I come back to the point I've maintained with the committee over a number of occasions. We came the closest to being overtopped in our National Health Service during Omicron compared to any other part of the experience around COVID.
Thanks, Camille.
Thank you. Brian Mitchell.
Thank you. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Good morning. Good morning to colleagues. I just wanted to follow on a little bit from what my colleague John Mason said there around occupied beds. And I think you alluded to this, Cabinet Secretary, that there's starting to switch. I think we heard this earlier on. There's starting to switch from those numbers of COVID cases that are occupying those beds are starting to be taken up by other conditions. Are we getting to a point here where sort of delayed presentation of other conditions is coming forward, and is that the next crisis really that we expect in the NHS, and that in itself will maintain a pressure?
I don't think I have the precise comparative numbers in front of me today, so if Mr. Whittle forgive me, I'll give rough-ish numbers from my recollection. When the government set out the strategic framework 3 weeks ago, the number of people in hospital with COVID was around about, I think 1,060 comes to my mind, but it was around about that sort of number. The number on Tuesday, 3 weeks on, was just a few short of 2,000. It had virtually doubled in the space of 3 weeks. Now, that is why the government has not followed through on all of the steps that we intended to take on the 21st of March because of that high level. And obviously there's a world of a difference between having roughly 1,000 patients in hospital with COVID and having 2,000 patients in hospital with COVID, because that opens up significant challenges about isolation of care, treatment of patients with COVID, isolating them from other patients, which undermines hospital capacity. So we really do need to see those numbers coming down significantly. I think we're seeing the signs of that now, but we need to see further reductions to enable that to be the case, to create the space for a smoother access to hospital care from people with a variety of other conditions.
Thank you for that, Cabinet Secretary. I think where I'm going to hear is that my concern here is that if we get COVID to the levels that we hope we can and bring it down, the pressure on the health service will only move across to other conditions that have sort of been delayed in presentation. I mean, is that a reasonable assumption to make?
Yes, that's absolutely a fair assumption. That it's just simply, the issue that I think that most troubles leaders in the health service just now is that because of the point that Mr. Whittle puts to me, that we've come out of an intense period of managing COVID, likely to be followed by an intense period of managing, let's call it, non-COVID. Mm. We're going from winter in the National Health Service is lasting an awful long time. In fact, winter feels like it's here all the time. Mm. So the winter pressures of sort of October to March don't look, we're just about at the end of March, and it doesn't look like the situation in hospitals is relaxing to any extent whatsoever. So that involves a huge burden on members of staff who are already very tired. Some of them will have been ill as well, and maybe still trying to recover fully. One of the issues about COVID, as we all know, is people are often experience fatigue for a longer period. So, these are demanding shifts that people are very demanding shifts that people are putting in the health service. If they're tired when they start them because of the implications of perhaps having had COVID themselves, which is highly likely given where they're working, then that's an additional burden for the health service to manage.
So there's three categories that will continue the pressure, no question, and they're very predictable. They are late presentations of new disease, they are existing presentations which we have on waiting lists, and mental health. And all of them are worse post-COVID because of COVID, because of what we had to do. You can't treble intensive care without having an effect on what you can provide. You simply can't. There is some positive news in there. I mean, we don't have any flu to talk of. We don't have any RSV to talk of. And some of that elective care is done by different teams from the teams I discussed in the previous session and DFM's just mentioned that are tired. So some of our surgical teams are very, very much ready to go, looking forward to getting back to some of that. But about 15% of our beds still have COVID patients in them. So the key, and I know we say it all the time, is to get that prevalence down, and then you can get stuck in, forgive the tone, into those three categories, because we have to get those three lots done. I've said this before in this committee, 40% of people who end up with a cancer diagnosis don't have a cancer referral. They have a referral for something else, and then we discover they have cancer during their pathway. So if you wait on an outpatient waiting list for pain, lump, something, and you wait a long time, your cancer diagnosis will be late. And that's true here. It's true in every major developed healthcare system in the world. That's why we need to get into those waiting times and the late presentations.
So the question is, and we know this is coming, and it's not an issue. It's isolated here. It's a global issue, I'm quite sure. But knowing that it's coming, how do we prep for the fact that, you know, as I said, there are conditions there that are going to, you know, continue to cause that pressure on the health service. How do we prep for it?
Essentially, we have got to make considered judgments about the prioritisation of cases and resources throughout the pandemic. Although some treatments have been paused, we have maintained cancer treatment. It is important that we've also maintained emergency care intervention for individuals. What we have to make sure is that we prioritise and that we maximise the capacity. So the recovery plan proposals that the Health Secretary has set out are about expanding capacity, about recruiting more personnel to support us, about making sure we've got all of the capacity in place to enable us to support people, and then to maintain our vigilance and practical intervention to try to suppress the levels of COVID, which obviously, as Professor Leach has just said, occupies a significant amount of capacity within the National Health Service.
Can I move on to Jim Fairley, please?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Mr. Swinney, Alec Riley asked if testing would continue to be free for people, and you responded yes. But John Mason has then asked, after April, will people have to pay for it? So I'm confused at your answering, or have I picked that up wrong?
No, I didn't say that to John Mason at all. No, I said
no.
No. It, obviously, the requirement for, you know, we're currently advising people to test on a twice weekly basis.
Yeah.
That advice will stop
in April.
Yes. But if there is a requirement for people to test, as you know, there are some other requirements within the testing plan, in the schematic, which indicates, you know, testing to protect high risk, testing for clinical care, and these will go on beyond April. They will be free.
Okay, that clarifies that. Thank you very much. But coming back to John Mason's point, if you wish to continue to test, might not be on a regular basis, but for a particular reason, because you're going to a care home or an elderly relative, that will still be, that won't be available free of charge as it currently is at the moment.
Well, the obligation isn't there for people to do so. That's what's different.
Yeah. Okay.
So the judgment is made about the change in definition is what's high risk and what isn't. Free testing will remain for high risk settings. If you're visiting a care home, we anticipate you still being provided with free LFDs before you go to the care home. But Mr. Mason's quite legitimate question is, will he get a free LFD test to visit an elderly relative in a house, not a care home? He will not. That's what the Test and Protect transition plan says.
Right, OK. Would the government prefer to be able to continue to be able to supply free tests for people who wanted to continue testing?
I think there's a... there is a fine judgment here, because there is a point, and government has to wrestle with this question at all times about what is proportionate action. If, for example, the prevalence of COVID reduces significantly within our society, but we are still testing as if it was as virulent as it has been in recent weeks, then I think the government would face some challenges about the proportionality of our actions and our requirements and the use of public money.
Okay.
Because of the fact that there was not a community-wide prevalence that would perhaps justify a testing infrastructure of the type that we've had in place up until now, which is why the risk-based assessment, which is included in the transition plan, is relevant for the judgments that we have made.
Okay. However, I'm going to challenge you on that. We've just heard evidence to say that this week has been the hardest week in hospitals from the Health Secretary because of the pressures of COVID. It is now early March and we're talking about this being phased out by April. Are you confident that we can relax the testing regime by the end of April, given the numbers where we are at the moment?
We think that is the case because, as I've said in my previous answers, we believe we have passed the peak of the BA2 variant. And we see that in a number of respects. We see it in cases. We see it in hospital admissions. And, you know, although the numbers in hospital are high, they're not being added to with the same vigour as was the case before. So, providing that pattern continues, but you know, I would contend, and I know it's a contested proposition, not everyone agrees with us, I would contend that in the face of the evidence Mr. Fairley puts to me, the government has taken prudent steps to deal with that. You know, if for example, we'd gone ahead and removed the legal obligation around face coverings on Monday, then I would think Mr. Fairley would have legitimate additional questions to put to me. Mm-hmm. But we took that decision to some controversy. A number of people are kicking off about it. But in my view, it was the responsible thing for us to do, to provide a bit more protection to try to get this under control.
OK, I am definitely one of the more cautious ones, and I want to see a continuation of testing. I want to make sure that we know where this virus is. So that takes me on to a technical question for Jason Leach. Mr. Swinney has on a number of occasions now talked about wastewater testing. Can you explain that, please?
Yeah, I'll try and do it politely since it's in the morning.
There's not a polite way of describing this.
Fundamentally, when you're positive with COVID, you shed virus in your bodily fluids, whatever those bodily fluids might be. We can find genetic material of COVID in the sewage around the country. So depending on where those sewage sites are, and how small or big they are, we can tell where the COVID is, in rough terms. And it gives us an early warning, because you shed it in your bodily fluids often before you have symptoms. So, since the Deputy First Minister is sitting beside me, the Three Sisters chicken outbreak, do you remember that?
Yes.
I gave them an extra sister. You've exaggerated
one sister,
50%. So the Two Sisters,
the Two Sisters
chicken factory. We know that COVID was there because we have it in the sewage plant that relates to that plant, because there was so many people around it. We can also do that in relatively localised areas of Glasgow, for example. So you can tell. And it gives us an early warning where we would then be able to intervene with outbreak management, with advice to the population. And it also, crucially, just recently, that science has allowed us now to also do genetic testing. so we can now tell which variant is in which place. That's just coming online. So think of it as an early warning score for COVID outbreaks in an area. So if we were going to have one in a big call centre or in Arbroath or Elgin, we would get early warning.
Okay. My cautious approach will accept your signs, but I'd much rather still see people testing on a regular basis.
And it doesn't replace that. It doesn't replace it. It adds to our ability to do surveillance. It certainly doesn't replace individual testing.
Yeah, but I think that's where we come back to. That essentially, I think in my answer, I think it was perhaps to the convener's question, or maybe Mr. Fraser's, we are operating at two levels. There is population-wide surveillance. For a large measure up until now, has been significantly informed by PCR and lateral flow tests. We're now moving to a situation where population-wide surveillance will be through wastewater and through ONS infection surveys. And that's a recognition of the fact that the pandemic is changing, and the strategic framework that the government set out indicates the developments that are taking place within the pandemic and how we need to respond to that. And I think I think it's appropriate that we have to adapt our stance as the nature and the composition of the pandemic changes over time.
Okay, I genuinely take your point, but I'm sitting here in this committee asking you these questions. We're also talking about people's perception of where we are with the virus. You quite rightly talked earlier on about people are thinking, well, Omicron is okay, but you're wanting to flip that idea around. It just seems to me that taking away of testing adds another layer of complacency in people's thinking.
I think there's, I accept there is a danger that people become complacent about COVID. I accept that unreservedly. But what I would want to assure the committee about is that the government doesn't take that view. That is why we have insisted on having population-wide surveillance activity underway, so that we are able to assess what is the general position on infection. Some of the wastewater sampling allows us to narrow that down to particular parts of the country to see where areas are perhaps more intense than others, which then can inform outbreak management, because we will still be active in the whole field of outbreak management. That's what some of the regulations that the committee will consider today is all about, to enable us to be able to undertake that type of outbreak management. Without those regulations, we can't do that outbreak management as well as we should be able to do it. And then there is the risk-based approach to testing that's inherent in the testing plan that has been issued by the government.
Okay, thank you. Got time to ask about the outbreak management? Very quickly, sorry, I know I'm taking up a lot of the time. I am skimming through the strategic framework update, and there is a paragraph here: to inform the response to an outbreak of a potentially dangerous variant of COVID-19, the Scottish Government, with Public Health Scotland, local government and other partners, are developing a COVID-19 outbreak management plan, which will set out the process and methods for responding to future outbreaks. We aim to publish this in spring. How far away from publishing are you?
It will be shortly. Essentially, the thinking around that has been informed by 2 years of experience of dealing with a variety of different outbreaks of different shapes and sizes around the country. Professor Leach mentioned the significant outbreak at the Two Sisters plant. We've had a number of other examples of that in industrial settings, in educational settings, in community settings, in localities. And local health protection teams have developed a lot of good intelligence about how to respond in certain given circumstances. I can remember in relation to the Two Sisters plant, the very effective approach taken by the public health team in Tayside, who decided not to recommend a localised lockdown, but to recommend isolation for the staff and their families. It was a supremely successful intervention well executed, well communicated. Essentially, that population was insulated from the rest of the population and there was no community transmission. Now, that is possible at certain moments in the pandemic. I think in the period going forward, that is a more likely intervention than perhaps in the last 6 to 9 months, where we've had extensive community prevalence. Tactics of that type have been less relevant, but the plan will essentially draw on that expertise that has been built up over the last 2 years.
OK, thank you. And we will come on to the legislative side of things next. Thank you.
A brief question about Brian Whittle, and then we'll move on to agenda item number 3.
Thank you, Fiona. I appreciate the opportunity. I just wanted to move a little bit further along the line from my colleague Jim Fairley there around, I think it was alluded to earlier, what should be continued to be monitored on an ongoing basis as we travel this journey. And Professor Leach had said earlier, where the Cabinet Secretary for Health had mentioned the extensive data that came in the Lancet about a global measurement there. So what should we be continuing to be monitored from a global perspective, so that we can input into a global perspective maybe the World Health Organization advice on data gathering? And how do we drill that down into what we want to measure locally and continue to monitor locally? What should we be monitoring?
I think there's different elements to this. We have to continue to monitor locally for two purposes, I think. One is to assess prevalence and therefore do we have the right positioning? The strategic framework sets out a risk level that we consider ourselves to be at. We consider ourselves to be at a medium risk level just now. I hope we can get to a low risk level fairly soon. But obviously, if we get to a high risk level, then we've got to take other steps. And that's about outbreak. That's about pandemic management within our own society, for which we have absolute responsibility. But there's a second element, which is about our contribution towards the global understanding of where we are. And particularly, I think, and Professor Leach may add different elements to what I'm saying, but I think we have an absolute obligation to make sure we are able to alert every other jurisdiction if we see the emergence of a new variant within our own society. That's a global obligation of ours. That we, if we've got something that develops here, some development of the virus that happens in Scotland, we must be able to identify that and to share that with others. So it's at those two levels. How we control the pandemic in Scotland, do we have the right positioning? Are we, is what's in the strategic framework and the testing framework appropriate for the times, or do we need to shift that? And secondly, are we able to contribute towards the international understanding of what is happening with COVID? Because without the tremendous research that was undertaken in Southern Africa, we would not have had as much information of the quality that we got about Omicron that we did, which helped us to respond as quickly as we did and avert what I consider to be a very serious risk of the undermining of our National Health Service. I don't know if you want to add.
Yeah, that covers surveillance very well. Those are the two things we need to know. We need to know numbers and we need to know variants, and we need to know that globally. I mean, there is almost no testing in Haiti. So if the variant comes from Haiti, we're going to be completely in the dark. And there is extensive genetic testing in South Africa. So if it comes from South Africa, we'll know. And if it comes from here, we'll know. I would argue, as I did in the previous session, you need two other things. You need research for disease course, so you need to know how the disease is changing, who it's affecting, who's living, who's dying, and you need to know treatment. So you have to continue to follow people this early in a new infection, 2 years since this disease arrived. You have to know if your drugs are working or not, and that requires considerable resource and investment and following patients over a long period, and trials with universities, but also government support across the UK and across the world to allow us to get better at finding it and treating it.
Thank you. And that concludes our consideration of this agenda item, and I'd like to thank the Deputy First Minister and his officials for their evidence today. I now move on to the third agenda item, which is consideration of the motions on the made affirmative instruments considered during the previous agenda item and two instruments which we took evidence on in our meeting on the 24th of February. Deputy First Minister, would you like to make any further remarks on the SSIs listed under agenda item 3 before we take the motions?
I think there's perhaps only some comments for the record that I put on in relation to the contents of the regulations, but the Coronavirus Act 2020 alteration of expiry date, Scotland Regulations 2022, changed the expiry date of temporary provisions in the UK Coronavirus Act 2020 by a further 6 months, thus ensuring that specific powers in the UK Act will continue to be available to ministers until the 24th of September 2022. The Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions Directions by Local Authorities Scotland Amendment Regulations 2022 changed the expiry date of the Local Authority Direction Regulations and will ensure that the powers given to local authorities in those regulations continue to be available to manage local outbreaks of coronavirus. The Coronavirus Scotland Act's Amendment of Expiry Dates Regulations 2022 extends all the provisions in Part 1 of each of the two Scottish Coronavirus Acts from 31st March to 30th September 2022, except for four provisions that have been expired by a further statutory instrument. The Coronavirus Scotland Act's Early Expiry Provisions Regulations 2022 expires four provisions in the two Scottish Coronavirus Acts. The Health Protection Coronavirus Requirements Scotland Amendment No. 5 Regulations 2022 remove from the Health Protection Coronavirus Requirements Scotland Regulations 2021 the principal regulations, the provisions in relation to the COVID-19 vaccine certification scheme.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. Are members content for the motions on the agenda to be moved en bloc with a set of the three extension regulations relating to the UK and Scottish Coronavirus Acts being taken all together, followed by the remaining two instruments?
Agreed.
Thank you. Members are agreed to move the motions en bloc as I have outlined. Can I now ask the Deputy First Minister to move en bloc motions S6M-03075, S6M-03169 and S6M-03349.
Moved en bloc, Convener.
Thank you. Can I ask for any comments from members? Meadow.
Thank you, Convener. Consistent with the view we've taken on other occasions, I want to oppose these motions. We've been round the houses on this issue a number of times, and I won't tire the committee by going over all the arguments again. These instruments seek to extend by another 6 months the emergency powers taken by the Scottish Government to deal with the coronavirus pandemic. We had some discussion earlier around the paper in The Lancet last week, which is the first peer-reviewed global estimates of excess deaths, which does observe that there is no clear relationship between levels of excess mortality and different levels of restrictions. In addition to that, given that we know the public adhere quite strictly to public health guidance, my view would be that we proceed to help address COVID through public health guidance rather than extending these extraordinary and emergency powers by another 6 months, which is what these instruments seek to do. Now, in so doing, I should recognise there are aspects of what's covered here that are beneficial. For example, the provisions that allow nurses to administer vaccines rather than doctors. As ever, it is the classic challenge for an opposition party that we cannot amend these statutory instruments before us. We have to either accept them as a whole or reject them as a whole, and given the extent of the emergency powers that they seek to extend, in this case, we have to reject them as a whole. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Can I bring in John Mason, please?
Thank you, Convener. As we've just heard in the session, we have 1,999 people in hospital. Hopefully things will get better, but things could get worse. There could be more variants in the next few weeks. So this is not the time to be ending these emergency powers.
Thank you, Mr. Mason. Jim Fairley and then Alex Rowley.
Thank you, Convener. I wholeheartedly agree with what Mr. Mason has said, and for the record, I simply don't understand. Murdo Fraser has just said that, by and large, the people of the country are following the rules or the guidance and everything that's there, and yet in the chamber yesterday, Sandesh Gulhani was opposing the wearing of masks because most people don't wear them properly anyway. I just don't see the consistency of that message, and right now, given the numbers that we've got, I see it would be crazy to be doing anything other than keeping the possibility of using restrictions if we need them.
Thank you, Mr. Fairley. Alex Fairley.
Yeah, I mean, I think the point John Mason makes about where we're at in terms of this is by far this virus is not over. And I only hope and pray that we don't have other variants and we end up having to go backwards again. And there's no certainty any of that. But given where we are, given where we've been, I think the majority of the people in Scotland believe that it's not unreasonable, given the level of COVID. Somebody said to me the other day, everybody knows somebody who's got COVID.
Yeah.
So given where we are, I just don't think it's unreasonable that you would have some of these protections, like face coverings. As I saw on TV last night in a BBC interview programme, if somebody said, if this is the worst that I have to suffer, given the suffering that has been in Scotland, if the worst I have to do is wear a mask for a few more weeks and have these protections there, then it seems to me perfectly reasonable. And I actually think it's more about playing party politics that we're even having this debate than anything else. It's about division, trying to create division where we should be creating unity. So I will certainly support this today.
Thank you, Mr. Rowley. Mr. Whittle.
I've got to be honest, I'm disappointed with Mr. Rowley's categorisation of that, because it's entirely not the case here. I think that what the general public don't know is the majority of the rules that they're facing are not law. They are guidance, and they have been following that. And I think my issue here is that the speed in which we can bring emergency legislation to this Parliament, as has been demonstrated, it means that, in my view, there's no need to continue with the emergency legislation. If that is required in the future, it can be brought very swiftly and very quickly to the Parliament. And I reiterate to Mr. Rowley, this is nothing to do with party politics. This is actually the fact of the matter is that the majority of the rules that we follow are guidance, and they're not legislation, and they're not rules, and they're not law.
Thank you. Can I ask the Deputy First Minister if he'd like to respond to any of his comments?
Thank you very much, Convener. I think these arguments have been well aired, and I think the points that have been made by Mr. Mason and Mr. Rowley recognise the fact that the pandemic is in no shape or form over. And as a consequence, we have to have available to us the measures that enable us to respond should we face a deterioration in the situation. Mr. Fairley put to me the issue about local outbreak management. Well, the direction, the health protection coronavirus restrictions directions by local authorities, Scotland Amendment regulations, provide for exactly the necessary interventions that are required for effective outbreak management if we are trying to deal with the situation where local outbreaks potentially create a wider difficulty. So the government seeks the extension that is required here to enable us to have the capacity, should we need it, to respond, not because we will do so, not because we will exercise these powers, but to give us the capacity to do so as members of the public would expect us to do. So I would appreciate if the committee would support the regulations that are in front of the committee today.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. Members are not agreed, so there will be a division. We will now move to a vote on the motions taken en bloc. Can I ask those members who agree? Sorry. So if I could please ask, the question is that motions S6M-0305, S6M-0369 and S6M-03349 be agreed. Do members agree?
Yes.
No. Okay. Sorry. There is a division, and we will now move to a vote on the motions taken en bloc. Can I ask those members who agree with the motion to raise their hand? Can I ask members who do not agree with the motion to raise their hand? Thank you. The clerks will record the result. And we have four for the motion and two against. Therefore, the motions are agreed to. Thank you. We will now move on to the second grouping of the motions, and I invite the Deputy First Minister to move on block motions S6M-03202 and S6M-03354. Thank you. Has any comments from members in relation to these ones? Thank you. I note that no member has indicated that they wish to speak, so I will now put the question on the motions. The question is that motions S6M-03202 and S6M-03354 be agreed to. Do members agree?
Yes.
Thank you. The motions are agreed to. Thank you, and that concludes the votes on the motions for this agenda item. The committee will publish a report to the Parliament setting out our decision on the statutory instruments considered at this meeting in due course. That concludes our consideration of this agenda item and our time with the Deputy First Minister. And I'd like to thank the Deputy First Minister and his supporting officials for their attendance today. And I suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to leave. Thank you. Move on to agenda item number four, which is subordinate legislation. I now move to the fourth agenda item, which is consideration of SSI 2022/64, which we took evidence on under agenda item number two. Members should refer to paper four in our meeting pack, as well as a policy note that accompanies the instrument. This is a negative instrument, and the deadline for lodging a motion to annul is the 19th of April 2022. This instrument expires some of the provisions in the Scottish Coronavirus Acts, which are outlined in the policy memorandum for the instrument. The DPLR committee considered the instrument on the 1st of March and has no points to raise. A motion to annul the instrument has not been lodged to date. Does any member wish to make any comments on this negative instrument? No. Are members therefore content to agree that we have no recommendations to make on this instrument? Thank you. We have agreed to make no recommendations. The committee's next meeting will be on the 24th of March, and we will continue to take evidence on the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill. That concludes the public part of the meeting this morning, and I move this meeting into the private session for our consideration on the final agenda item. Thank you.